Welcome to our continuing series on the 17 Sustainable Development Goals developed by the United Nations. Today, our speaker is Nico Pooran Latorre, who is an experienced project leader at Oliver Wyman, a strategy consulting firm, where he advises energy, retail, and consumer goods, private equity, and industrial clients on growth strategy topics. He also serves as a board member and advisor of Quantica Education, a Colombian-based company that aims to advance social entrepreneurship in the region. Prior to joining Oliver Wyman, Nico spent time working as an investment banker at Deutsche Bank and holds a bachelor and a master's degree in applied mathematics and statistics from Johns Hopkins University. Over to you, Mr. Latorre.
Thanks, Dr. Durback and World Information Transfer for having me on today to hear a little bit about platforms for change and ways businesses are really pushing the envelope to achieve the UN Sustainable Development Goals. Perhaps let's start with a little bit more of my story. I'm originally from Colombia in South America. But I spent most of my life living outside of Colombia in Brazil, Venezuela, Belgium, Spain, and finally the U.S. Whereas Dr. Durback mentioned, I went to Johns Hopkins University and got my bachelor's and master's in applied math. My professional story is quite focused on business, right? I've done consulting work at EY. I've done investment banking at Deutsche Bank, and now I do growth strategy for energy and retail consumer goods, as Dr. Durback mentioned, at Oliver Wyman. I think growing up outside of Colombia and really seeing how the country has evolved and taking into account its history has really made me and made me want to leave an impact there. And I think a lot of the decisions that I've made throughout my career have been geared towards that. So without a doubt, that's a little bit about myself. And what I want to do today is I want to talk about how businesses are really changing the way they operate and pushing forward to achieve the Sustainable Development Goals. And I want to do that across four dimensions, which I'll get into shortly. With that, let's jump in. I think, you know, from my perspective, there's really four key platforms for change, right? And I think most people will be familiar with many of them, right? The first is governments. Second are NGOs and nonprofits. The third are large corporations. And the fourth are small and medium-sized businesses. At least that's how I've come to think about it. I think each of these play a critical role in advancing the UN SDGs, and only working together are we going to really achieve them in the long term, right? And I think, you know, governments are obviously one of the key players. They have the power to drive behaviors, whether it's through subsidies, whether it's through regulations, for example, with new car sales, right? And creating subsidies there. NGOs and nonprofits are incredibly powerful and mission critical at really supporting research and setting the agenda, right? Among other things. Large corporations are really, and this is a point I want to hit home today, are accelerators, right? They support infrastructure development, for example, for automotive OEM building electric vehicles. They create offerings, for instance, with financial institutions building sustainable credit cards. And they have the capital, more importantly, to market and influence behaviors as well. The last one is small and medium-sized businesses. These players are really important and frequently an overlooked platform because they're small, right? But ultimately, these are players that are innovating, they're changing their business model, they're developing new technologies, they're pushing to new frontiers. And we're seeing how the business world values them more and more as private market investments, for instance, in venture capital, reach record highs. I think in 2022, some peers at Oliver Wyman did an analysis and identified that over $10 billion in investments were made to climate energy companies. So today, what I'd like to do is I want to focus on the business component of these platforms. I want to focus on large corporations and small and medium-sized businesses, and specifically, right, how these platforms can activate change. What are some of the challenges and barriers? What are the kind of the best-in-class examples out there? And what some of the early successes have been. So within large corporations, I really want to draw on my own experience at Oliver Wyman with energy and gas stations to show how they played a pivotal role in the adoption of electric vehicles and therefore, right, supporting those long-term UN SDGs, specifically around climate and sustainability. At the highest level, right, if we think about how ultimately we get electric vehicle adoption to come to life, it's really about balancing supply and demand, right? Supply of electricity, supply of the infrastructure that is going to enable charging of those electric vehicles, and then ultimately, right, demand for electric vehicles from consumers, right? So I will say the demand side, and I'm going to talk about each of these components, right, to paint that picture. The demand side is pretty well known, right? It's what we all know and we see as in the market is improved electric vehicle sales, right? We see that there are states like California, like Washington, that have really reached new records of those sales and where electric vehicles are becoming more prominent. And, you know, I think as part of that has been a result of really what I like to call the rise of the sustainable consumer, right? Which is how individuals have become more conscious over time of their effect on the environment, but also government regulations and subsidies that are becoming more stringent and that are making the purchase, the infrastructure of electric vehicles more available. So let's talk a little bit about what are some of the key factors that are worrying consumers and that are almost preventative on the demand side, right? I think a lot of studies have been done and they show that really there's three main factors that are driving a bit of hesitance around electric vehicles, right? It's single charge travel distance, right? So your ability or the car's ability rather to drive a prolonged distance without running out of a charge. Charger availability, right? So that's essentially, right? How frequently can I see a charger on the road? And lastly, price point. I think when electric vehicles originally came out, they were more expensive than a average or traditional, what we call ICE vehicle, internal combustion engine. And therefore, right, it was only or more available to affluent populations. I think the good news here is that on the demand side, a few of these concerns have been mitigated or are being mitigated over time, right? And most of that is driven by advances in technology, right? I think we've seen dramatic improvements in how far traditional electric vehicles can go on a single charge, right? I think many or most electric vehicles can now go 200 miles on a single charge. You know, just as a reference point, it takes, you can go to from New York to Philadelphia, two major cities and back with a 200 mile charge. So while some of the concerns are there, right, especially if you live in rural areas where you might need to go more than 200 miles, for most people living in urban, suburban populations, a single charge is typically more than good enough for you to go a full day, right, for you to be a commuter. The other concern is cost, right? And as I mentioned, electric vehicles have traditionally been more expensive, but we've seen a dramatic reduction in the price for electric vehicles, and that's across the board, right? It comes from all components of what it takes to make an electric vehicle. And I think one of the biggest reduction in price has been in the production of battery packs. And I think a lot of people believe that over the next kind of 5 to 10 years, there's going to be price parity between electric vehicles and internal combustion engines. The third concern and the third real challenge, which is the one that people know slightly less about, right, is charger availability. Right. And the charger availability really brings us to the supply side of the equation. Really, for large-scale EV adoption to work at all, you need to have EV chargers, right? You need to have EV chargers, whether it's at home, whether it's at on the road, and they're public at a station, at a gas station like a BP or a Total or a Shell, or even if they're now coming out and, you know, maybe it's near a supermarket, for instance, right? That infrastructure needs to be there for the adoption to be wide scale. And I think the issue here, the thing here is energy providers across the board, right? Whether it's an energy company like Shell or Exxon, whether it's a utility provider like Duke Energy, or whether it's, you know, a OEM automotive manufacturer like Mercedes-Benz or BMW, they have to come out with a charger, a way to have a provision of electricity to charge these vehicles. The challenge here is that for many other industries, right, really what is required for you to become a more sustainable company and support the energy transition is simply to create a new offering, for instance, right? And I think I mentioned the example before of how financial services institutions are creating a new credit card offering that's more sustainable or more attractive to the sustainable consumer. For energy companies, it's a complete rethinking of their business model. It's a complete change of their business model. And therefore, it's going to take time. It's going to take time and investment. Let's talk about what needs to change for these energy companies, right? It's not only the method of fueling that fundamentally changes, but it's also the location, right? Currently, you know, most consumers will go to a gas station. They'll fuel their car. It'll take maybe 5 minutes and they'll leave. And gas stations are available pretty much everywhere. What happens with electric vehicle charging? 80% of electric vehicle charging is done at home, approximately. Which means that energy companies now need to go from being in the business of providing to not only providing energy fueling, if you will, at a gas station, but they also need to provide the ability and the capability to do it for consumers to do it at home. And that's one type of charging, right? Those chargers typically take, call it 10 hours, and people charge them overnight. The other component of it is now they also have to pick the specific locations where they're going to start to offer electrical vehicle charging and install superchargers where you can charge them in 10 minutes. So it's a complete rethinking of their business model. And along with that, because consumers will now be at the gas station or the electric vehicle station for 10 to 20 minutes, they need to provide the consumer the ability on the convenience side to be able to stay there for longer. Right? So that means maybe creating a restaurant, maybe creating seating, offering different kinds of services in the convenience store. So it really is a big change. And the benefit of it is it can be profitable. And there are avenues to where at the intersection of these public corporations and the UN SDGs, there is benefit for both, right? For example, for large corporations, it is if they're there, if the consumer is there at the station for longer, charging their vehicle, they're going to go into the convenience store more often. And if you're like myself, that goes in and just buys a Coke, right? And you're charging your car for 10 to 20 minutes, you're going to go in and maybe you'll buy a sandwich, right? Maybe you'll have lunch. So there is benefit to both. And that's where there needs to be a little bit more, there requires collaboration to build out that infrastructure. One of the big benefits here, and one of the things that we're already seeing, and I think a lot of people see major energy companies as almost an impediment, right, to moving forward with electric vehicle adoption. But the reality is it's going to be almost impossible for broad scale EV adoption to occur unless these energy companies provide their investment and change the infrastructure, right? And we're all, the benefit is we're already seeing this in the market, right? We're seeing it with companies like BP coming out with BP Pulse, right? And they provide at-home and public charging. Or Shell coming out with Shell Recharge, which basically is an attempt by these large energy companies to compete with more established networks like ChargePoint and EVgo. So ultimately, coming back to the platform for change, large corporations are going to play a pivotal role, right? They're going to support EV adoption. They're going to have to as consumers shift towards that direction. And that's going to allow us to achieve many of the UN SDGs over time. One of the best in class case studies that we can see where this is already happening and we're already seeing these platforms come and work together is in Norway. Right? Norway is the country with the single highest electric vehicle adoption. I think it's something like 20%+ of their car park. So of all the vehicles on the road are electric vehicles. I think in recent years, they had roughly 80% of new car sales be electric vehicles. And that didn't happen just by the consumer demand, right? It happened by 20+ years of the government incentivizing electric vehicles and disincentivizing internal combustion engines, right? It happened with the government investing in infrastructure. But it, there was also a large component of it that was large corporations going in and saying, all right, I see this as the path forward. I'm going to invest in the infrastructure. And a good example of that is Circle K, which is a convenience store operator owned by Couche-Tard, owns 9,000+ global convenience stores. And they basically built out dedicated stations in Norway that were new highway sites with solar panels to, again, attract that sustainable consumer. Large stores that had restaurants with broader food offerings, right? So again, back to the example I gave before, not just providing things like a Coca-Cola, a bag of chips, but they could provide a salad, right? They could provide a sandwich, right? And again, these, while they help UN SDGs, it's also in the long term profitable for these companies. Healthy, fresh, and convenient food are higher margin products than a traditional Coca-Cola at a convenience store, right? So it is a mutual beneficial relationship, but it's one that's going to take time. And only through that collaboration, as we've seen in Norway, are we going to be able to get there. So that's really the first piece that I wanted to talk about. I wanted to talk about how large corporations are intricately involved in the advancement of UN sustainability goals and how they're already starting to get there and where they're pushing the envelope more and what examples we can draw from it to support countries that are trying to get there, right? Like the United States, like Canada, where we've set ambitious targets for electric vehicle or new car sales and where the regulations are coming forward. We're just a few years behind. Sounds like we'll come back to questions at the end, Dr. Durbeck.
Yes, questions will be at the end.
Great. The next piece I want to talk about is small and medium-sized businesses, the fourth platform for change that I mentioned. The reality is many of these businesses are often overlooked as having a direct impact. And it makes sense, right? They have the name small in them. They're small. They have less scalability. They have less influence across countries. So unlike a Shell or a Total or a BP, they can't affect change across North America, Europe, Asia, right? Now, that said, many of these firms, small, medium-sized businesses, act as change agents and oftentimes are the biggest innovators, right? Where they don't have the capital and influence to make mass change at scale, they are oftentimes the most powerful at affecting change within regions. Also, because they have the context of how things work at a more localized level. So with that, I want to talk about how those small and medium-sized businesses are making an effect in my home country of Colombia. And I think I mentioned before, I feel incredibly passionate about making a change in Colombia, especially after all those years living abroad. And one of the ways that I'm trying to do that is by being a board member and advisor to Quantica Education. Quantica Education is a company that it's directly supporting UN Sustainable Development Goals across climate and peace initiatives, among others. But I want to talk a little bit about what the ethos of Quantica really is to start. Quantica has mainly been focused on affecting positive change in Colombia, right? And the way that they do that is they believe that entrepreneurs can be positive system creators, right? So they can create the environment through which we can achieve goals bigger than ourselves. Therefore, they aim to act directly as a platform that enables and builds social and sustainable ventures. And they do that. Historically, they have a ton of new offerings that I'm really excited about that they're coming out with. But historically, they've done that in two ways. One, through education workshops, where they basically provide new ventures that, again, new companies that are trying to build a sustainable business with strategy, marketing, finance, networking, sales advice, right? Maybe sourcing and procurement advice sometimes, to train those entrepreneurs to launch their business and ultimately be able to function independently. And then the other way that they do it is through an in-person fair, right? Where they bring in the companies that they have those education workshops with, and they help them, they enable, they market them so they can sell their products. So they've done this. They've been doing this for several years. They've been massively successful. And again, mainly focused on Colombia. And I want to emphasize the regional component of the small and medium-sized businesses, because specifically with regards to Colombia, Quantica has been able to understand the market, understand the cultural, the political, the historical context of the country is coming from to affect real change. And large corporations have a much more difficult time doing that. So let's provide some context on Colombia to understand how Quantica bridged that gap. So many people will know this, so apologies if I'm being repetitive, but Colombia is a country with deep, deep, deep internal historical unrest. It's a country that went through a 50 plus year civil war due to conflict between guerrilla groups, right? So people may be familiar with the name Las FARC, which is a group that claimed to fight for poor people's rights by pushing a communist agenda. They fought deeply against paramilitary forces, right? And their agenda was in response to what they believed to be threats from the guerrilla groups. What people most hear about in Colombia historically is the third aspect or the third group that was contributing to that war, and those are the drug syndicates, and many people will know the Medellin and the Cali cartel, right? And ultimately, the government just trying to keep the peace, right? And just trying to provide order and stability in the region. So basically, these kind of three to four groups fighting for over 50 years created a lot of violence, a lot of tension, a lot of displacement for the Colombian people. And that is a little bit of almost where we're coming from over time. Right. To give you a little bit more context and to add some statistics, right, to the degree of the conflict, I think it's been estimated that some 450,000 people have died in Colombia as a direct result of the armed conflict. And that's been mostly civilians, right? On top of that, it's estimated that 7 million people have been displaced in Colombia. For context, that's 7 million over 50 million people that currently are part of Colombia's population today. Again, those 7 million people were not all displaced this year, but 7 million people over time is a tremendous number. It's very, very impactful. So that's where we're coming from. And I want to share two ventures that Quantica has educated, that they've exposed in their fair to support peace development. We've talked a little bit about large corporations and how they advance climate change, but what I want to focus on in Colombia, because Quantica understands that the historical context, how they've been able to support peace development through these two ventures. So the first venture I want to talk about that Quantica supported is Manifiesta. Manifiesta is a Colombian clothing company that supports peace development through the reintegration of affected individuals by the armed conflict. So Manifiesta sells clothing. They sell things like kimonos, they sell blouses, they sell t-shirts, right? And they do so, really interestingly, by having ex-Las FARC. So again, one of the major guerrilla groups in Colombia, ex-Las FARC combatants and victims of the conflict, right? So maybe widows of individuals that were killed as part of the armed conflict in the army. And they have them collaborate together to produce clothes, and they sell those clothes, right? So not only has this initiative helped, and not only has this business helped reactivate ex-guerrilla members who were marginalized after their participation in the conflict, right? Help them reincorporate them into society. But it's also allowed, very interestingly, almost a safe medium for storytelling and conflict resolution between two opposing forces in that civil war. I think as a result of that kind of success story, more than 12,000 pieces of articles of clothing have been sold by Manifiesta, and they have a store in Bogota, Colombia's capital. So it's a company that's, again, produced a lot of change. It's supporting a big effort, and despite being small, it has a meaningful impact in Colombia. And Quantica, as a platform for change, is at the surface of that, pushing the envelope. The next venture I want to talk about is Caguan Expeditions. Now, what I think is really cool about Caguan Expeditions is it sits at the intersection of helping support peace, but then within Colombia, but then also building up sustainable tourism, right? So essentially what Caguan Expeditions does is it sells ecotourism packages, and it was born out of San Vicente del Caguan, which is in one of Colombia's Colombian Department of Caquetá. And Caquetá was one of the major hubs, almost the heart of the armed conflict in Colombia, right? So these were, and the founders of Caguan Expeditions are formerly ex-guerrilla members that upon the peace treaty being signed, they put down their guns and they founded Caguan Expeditions to basically take advantage of the fact that they were intimately familiar with all the different regions and the, honestly, quite frankly, the beautiful regions of that, of kind of the Caquetá region, right? And provide ecotourism to tourists, right? And so I think what's really cool, they provide rafting services, right? Along the rivers in Caquetá. And I think what's really interesting and what's really cool about the firm is that not only are they helping reintegrate a lot of the different members of the ex-guerrilla to the region, right? They were formerly marginalized and they're helping reintegrate them, but it's also fueling the economy of the region. And it's showing other kind of members of the armed conflict, that there is an alternative form of life, right? Almost a best-in-class success story for them to follow. One of my favorite facts about the story is that this particular group, the Karwan Expeditions team, got so good at rafting that they went on to compete in the Australian World Tournament. So those are my two examples of how Quantica, as a small to medium-sized business, is really creating a platform for change. And with their context, with their ambitions to drive change more locally, are supporting UN SDG that maybe receives less attention in the business world today. Right. And it shows that, you know, you can be a business and you can push these initiatives and still be a profitable entity. Right. So really across those four platforms, government, as entities like the UN, large corporations, small, medium-sized businesses, you can really, really affect change, but you need to do it all together. And with that, I'll pause. And really that was the objective of today's presentation. I wanted to introduce you to platforms for change among businesses and feel really passionate about the work, you know, some of the energy companies are doing, but then also more personally in Colombia, how Quantica and others are helping to kind of promote peace and ecotourism as well. Thanks. Well, thanks for giving me an opportunity to present.
Thank you, Nico. That was very, very interesting. And particularly now, we do have students from Ukraine and other parts of the world that are going to be asking questions in their countries. But I also wanted to mention that Colombia was one of the countries that we were considering to be our co-sponsor in our next UN conference because of the changes. And actually, one of our speakers, I think 2 years ago, was very much involved in the indigenous people in Colombia. So I do know something about it. All right, now we will move on to Susie, who will be asking the questions. Susie?
Thank you, Dr. Durbach, and thanks so much, Nico, for such an inspiring presentation. We have so many questions from the audience. So the first one being, Quantica Education appears to aim to support young entrepreneurs who will reduce poverty and inequality and promote positive community change confidently. Part of Quantica's philosophy is order and chaos, in which part of learning is to learn by innovation and push your comfort zone, after which you receive theory and conventions to make sense of that challenge. Could you please give examples of how this framework could be applied to issues like climate change and the other sustainable development goals?
Sure. I mean, it's, I think you said it right, Susie. There's a lot of kind of chaos, right, out there today in the market as to how we go about and we tackle climate change and the energy transition, right? I don't think anyone has one single solution, and it really does take a collaborative approach, right? One of the cool things coming back to the platforms is small and medium-sized businesses are the ones that are one of the entities that are most actively innovating, right? And so by educating themselves, by having entities like Quantica that can provide that education, that can provide a more structured framework in the context of that order and chaos, only then can these kind of small and medium-sized businesses aim to further build themselves up, innovate, push offerings into the market, and ultimately help achieve some of those climate change goals, right? Because they're not easy. We don't have a reference case of what's worked in the past. It's all new. And so that innovation is going to take place through, in part, small companies having that constant and consistent framework, right? And that's one of the things that's really, really inspiring about Quantica. They've developed a really rigorous education process that helps these entrepreneurs who are new to the business world, some of them, in deeply understanding their business, deeply understanding how to push their business forward in the context of all the order and chaos, potential competitors, right? Changing customer needs, right? The example coming back to the energy transition was consumer needs are changing constantly. And so with that framework, you arm entrepreneurs with the ability to not only take away from a single class and have something that's successful within 3 months, but maybe something that works down the line in 4 years, 5 years.
How can some of the Quantica initiatives you described be applied to other areas suffering from conflict, like Ukraine and Russia or Lebanon and Syria? The way you talked about how you can kind of bring groups that are on opposing sides of the war and that are civilians to work on something together was pretty inspiring. So how could that be applied elsewhere?
Look, it's a fantastic question. It's one that I'm sure it's been top of mind for me, even as I hear of the things that are happening elsewhere in the world, right? My sense is it's about creating the right framework and the right structure for these, for really these people to collaborate and create that kind of peace, right? So I think what's interesting about Quantica, what's interesting about Colombia, and first let's maybe take a step back, right? Colombia's conflict is in some ways near to its end, right? So a lot of these initiatives, they work because there's been some time since the major impacts of the conflict have been felt, right? Granted, I'm sure it's still happening, but it's not immediately impactful and ongoing like it may be in the Ukraine, right? That said, to answer your question, how can it be applied? It's about creating that framework. Right, creating the understanding what are the two different parties that have been deeply affected, again, focus on the past, have been deeply affected by the conflict. What is the kind of the common thread? How can you, through building a product, through building a business, show the humanity in both sides? And over time, right, allow them to, again, share stories, share what drove them to make their decisions, and in the long term, right, ultimately allow for that process of reconciliation to take place, right? And in the process, you reintegrate people that were marginalized as part of the conflict. So again, I think it's about creating the right framework and the right medium. The business itself matters less. Right? It's about what's the medium, what's the location, what's the context, what's the situation that's going to allow these people to come together with an open mind and listen to each other.
Very powerful. Can you explain how some of Quantica's selected businesses align to some of the other UN Sustainable Development Goals? Maybe how they're helping promote sustainable practices with less waste in the fashion and consumer goods space, for instance?
That's a great question. Quantica has also worked with a different company called Cyclico. And Cyclico is a provider, it's a creator of sustainable clothing, right? I think a lot of their clothing is made from recyclable material, which is non-wasteful. As a matter of fact, I probably should have worn one of their t-shirts. I have one in my closet. And they've done phenomenally well. Again, on the back of the rise of the sustainable consumer society, showing businesses that they want more than just cheap clothing. They want something that's sustainable, something that's non-wasteful. And so Quantica has partnered, has advised Cyclico in the past, and has really been able to help them push their business forward. And that's one that's directly related to sustainability, right? They're creating sustainable products. And again, still in the context of small to medium-sized businesses.
How can the workforce be made more sustainable and favorable to working people? How can working conditions be improved globally through technological innovations and sustainable cultures and principles? Are you aware of ways or examples of doing so?
ways in which companies, large corporations can make the business more sustainable, right? I would say it's driven by a couple of factors, right? One, and again, it comes back to that cross collaboration, right? One is when it comes to a workforce, work-life sustainability, there's certainly a lot to be said around the government's role in regulating the number of hours that are worked, right? The type of people that can work. So maybe, you know, for example, children not being able to work in a factory, right? The government has an important role to play, but so does the consumer, right? That's the other factor. The consumer has the ability to say, I'm not going to be an advocate for these practices by purchasing products that directly violate or are impacting sustainable practices in business. Once you have those two components working together, what is the business ultimately has to react, right? They have to say, okay, sales are down, people don't want to purchase my products. And on top of that, I'm getting pressure by local authorities to not have these practices. That's when the business can really activate measures. And that's when, from a business perspective, they're incentivized to activate measures to improve those conditions, right? Some companies will do it naturally. Other companies need the push. Either way, one really cool way that they're doing it these days is through data and analytics and labor force management, right? We see many more companies investing in programs, platforms that are going to provide data and analytics with insights around labor productivity, labor sustainability, right? And employee happiness, right? And I think this is a really topical question, because as our generations have shifted over time, we see that Gen Zers, for instance, care a lot more about having that sustainable work-life practice. And so employers are pushing the frontier and saying, how can I use data and analytics to inform my decision-making on what I do with these employees, what practices I want to kind of push forward with them, et cetera. So to answer the question, it's really creating sustainable practices. It's a collaboration, right? And it can be informed through best practices such as data and analytics.
How has working at large global consulting and investment banking firms shaped your outlook on the role corporations can play in combating the climate crisis and promoting environmental and social best practices?
I think it's shaped my view incredibly, in an incredible powerful way. I think a lot of the focus on business historically has been really on just profitability and driving growth, right? But ultimately, having had the opportunity growing up to move from country to country informed my perspective around, hey, how are other countries supporting climate and sustainability, right? What are some of the best practices that I can learn and take away? And working in consulting and investment banking has brought those opportunities and live examples where corporations can start to bring those to life. So it has had a very powerful impact on me, and it's something that I encourage clients to think about as they develop their growth strategies, as they think about their business plans. It's always a consideration, right? And that's for clients that maybe are not energy companies. And I think for energy company clients that I do have, it's very topical in all of their minds, right? Because as the climate change technology like electric vehicles grows, fuel demand for traditional petroleum products will decline. So for those companies, it's very top of mind. And we're seeing how they care more and more about it, not only because it's driven by the consumer, but it's also in their interest from a long-term growth perspective.
What advice can you give to young people who want to work in this space while also contributing to causes they're passionate about?
It's a great question. My biggest advice to you is really focus on, so to enter the business world, focus on building the right skill set, but also developing a story that shows why, one, you want to work in the business world, but how that can allow you to have an impact more broadly on society, right? Because once you're part of one of these big corporations, it's a little bit easier, or it is possible, if you reach a certain position, to have an impact, right? You can always have an impact, but it's one of the paths. It's a good path, right? Where by joining the business world, you can start to affect change at clients, at some of these large corporations, and in turn, even at small and medium-sized business ones. So the advice is build core critical skill sets and make sure you're showing how you can tie your past experiences to why you want to build change. The example there is, for me, I've always been really passionate about Colombia. I've always been really centered on helping Colombia. And I've put that at the forefront of my professional persona, if you will. And that has allowed me to show people that not only do I have the skill sets, but also it's a deep part of my personality that I want to make an impact with.
What challenges have you faced throughout your career, or difficulties you encountered in your work? Maybe some examples of how you overcame them.
It's a great question. I would say that one of the biggest challenges that I've had has, again, having that appetite to make an impact, right? Having that appetite to do something in Colombia that starts to make change. One of my biggest challenges has been really fulfilling that desire, right? It's working for a corporation. It's very easy to get siloed into the day-to-day of doing the job, but stepping back and saying, what am I doing to deliver an impact to society, right? How am I doing that? That has been one of the biggest challenges of my career so far. And it's from a professional perspective, but it's also from a personal front, right? Because on the professional side, it's, you can do it at work, but it may not be as meaningful, right? And I think for myself, not being a sustainability consultant, for example, I struggled a little bit to find that professional avenue. How I overcame it is twofold. One, by using my growing position at companies where I am. So as you develop a reputation, as you work, you're able to generate a certain expertise that then you can bring and you can show into initiatives that you care about. So again, connecting to that story, finding ways that you can say, I care about this, I've showed it to my clients, I've showed it in the business world, and now I want to take it back and deliver it to something that I really care about. So that's one, that's really how I found Quantica, right? And two, it's networking, right? A big part of the reason that I overcame that kind of almost personal professional challenge was by talking to people, by doing research, by understanding, you know, what ways are companies in Colombia, for example, how are they going about and delivering change, making an impact? And so that's one of the biggest challenges, and it's really networking and continuing to develop that story, rising up in your professional environment so that you can then bridge the two together.
Very helpful. Thank you. How did your applied mathematics education at Johns Hopkins, an interdisciplinary arts and sciences university, lead you to work in consulting and later advise a Colombian-based sustainable startup?
Going to Johns Hopkins, I'm very thankful for having had the opportunity to go to a university like Johns Hopkins. I think the combination of going to Johns Hopkins, studying applied math there, it really, 5 years down the line after going to university, you may remember 10 things, right? Or maybe five things 20 years down the line about applied math. What I'm thankful for from my degree is that it built a very strong skill set, and that is problem solving, right? Being a math major gives you the ability or generates the capability, as do many other engineering majors, to solve problems, right? How that's helped me is consulting is a problem-solving job. It's a job where clients come to you with a challenge, whether it's, you know, does it make sense to buy this company? Should I build electric vehicle stations in rural areas, or should I do them in urban areas? Should I buy an energy company in Asia? They're problems. And what the capability that I developed in university gave me was the ability to take that big problem and structure it in a way that is logical and makes sense. So for example, if you want to purchase, if you're thinking about installing an electric vehicle charger in the US, in a particular state, you want to look at a customer perception of electric vehicles, how many electric vehicles there are, what's the projected growth of electric vehicles, what competitors exist, et cetera, et cetera. So it's the ability to structure problems that I've gone from university that I'm thankful for and has allowed me to grow in consulting. And similarly enough, that same skill set has extended itself to Quantica, because small and medium-sized businesses often face even broader challenges, right? A small and medium-sized, where a large corporation may be asking themselves, does it make sense to introduce a new credit card? A small and medium-sized business should maybe asking themselves, I want to make an impact. Should I start an energy company or should I start a credit card company? It's a broader question, right? And oftentimes that's the case. And so the way it's helped me with Quantica is it's given me that skill set to go in with the leadership team, which is absolutely phenomenal, and work together to structure and solve some of their most challenging problems.
Very interesting. Thank you. Do you see each UN Sustainable Development Goal as standalone, or are they complementary and connected? For example, if we think about Sustainable Development Goal 8, decent work and economic growth, and 9, industry, innovation, and infrastructure, are these goals at all interrelated to number 13, climate action, and number 16, peace, justice, and strong institutions? Or do you think of these issues all as standalone?
I firmly believe that some of them are more interrelated than others. That being said, as I've looked at them in the past, what I found really interesting is that, yes, they are all to some degree interrelated. And for one of them to succeed, you do need elements of the others to be successful. Right? So for example, your industry and successful industries are highly interrelated with climate change in the longer term.
Thank you. The case example of the largest electric vehicle adoption in Norway that you talked mm-hmm. about was very fascinating. It was a great example of governments putting green policies in place and businesses investing and rolling out green energy sources and vehicles for consumers. Have you seen this type of activity in other global markets, or do you think the UN could play a role in promoting this in other countries?
I have seen it in other countries. It is it's more accelerated in Europe than it is in other parts of the world. And that, again, Norway has it, but other countries in Europe have it. It's less accelerated in North America, in the US and Canada. We are seeing it, right? We are seeing that acceleration start. It's more state-driven, right? Given states have more control over regulations and policies than in other places, right? So, but we are seeing it. It's just at a slower pace, right? Norway's the best in class example where we draw parallels and we try to almost in some way copy if we want to get there. But we are seeing that other countries in Europe, as well as countries in the Americas and Asia are also pushing to get there. And I'm sorry, Susie, what was the second part of the question?
Do you think the UN could play a role in promoting this in other countries?
Absolutely. Absolutely. I think the UN does a phenomenal job, and I think they should continue to set the agenda, continue being clear on what the electric vehicle goals for adoption need to be for us to ultimately achieve the goals. So they can play a pivotal role.
How do you think platforms for change drive innovation and support businesses, and how do they contribute to business social responsibility?
Yep. So I mean, platforms for change, right? As we think about a business, let's take the electric vehicle lens, right? And how a business come in and might want to be more sustainable, right? Primarily, if it's a for-profit business, they might have a very strong social agenda, but they will also have a for-profit agenda. And as consumers, governments, regulatory agencies start to become more stringent, as they did in Norway, right, to electric vehicle adoption, to incentives, to regulation, the businesses are going to be more incentivized to drive that innovation, right? And I think I touched on this a little bit. We've seen that innovation already take place, and it's taking place, whether it's through the reduction in price point, investments in making the technology cheaper so that people are less affected by the price disparity between electric vehicles and internal combustion engines, whether it's that, or it's extending the driving range on electric vehicles so that people are less worried about the fact that they may get stranded in the middle of nowhere because their electric vehicle ran out of battery, right? So it is intricately involved. It is important for business to have that lens, and that's how they can contribute, and that's how they have been contributing to innovation.
Thank you. How often do you meet young entrepreneurs, either at your company, through your university alumni networks, or your board position at Quantica?
Very often, very often. And it is inspiring to meet people who that are entrepreneurs that are starting something that, at least when it's a social responsible entity that's starting, want to make an impact, right? I think when you talk to the people at Quantica, for instance, it's so clear how purpose-driven they are. And it through them, it's that I've gotten involved in meeting more entrepreneurs, right? And understanding what drives and what motivates people, right? So very frequently, and it's, as I said, it's quite inspiring.
Do you work with any partners based in other countries, and do you like working with peers globally?
Absolutely. Absolutely. I mean, I think, as I mentioned before, my background has a pretty global nature, having grown up in a number of different countries, even across continents, right? And so I really value and enjoy having multicultural perspectives on the teams that I work with. I'm currently working on it with a partner out of Germany, right? So and I think it's crucial, because the perspective that someone in a different country is able to give is very different from something that I might be able to share here in the US. So enjoy it, do it incredibly frequently. And I think there needs to be more global collaboration, especially as we think about tackling the UN SDGs.
How has living and working in so many different countries shaped your perspective as a business leader and someone working in the sustainability space?
It has been very powerful. It has been very powerful to experience different business environments, because it changes your perspective on how to tackle problems, one. And it creates a more open mind within teams of what other people can contribute, right? And how different other people's perspectives can be. So within those two dimensions, it really has shaped the way I go about my day-to-day working with teams. And so incredibly powerful to have had that experience. And like I said before, I think it's something that all companies should strive to provide to their employees.
What kinds of projects have been most interesting or successful for you during your career? You probably can't share too much details, but maybe about the topic or types of work that you've liked.
Sure. The most rewarding project personally, and the one that I've found I would say there's been many of them, right? But one of the ones that was more personally rewarding was again, one that was directly related to developing that positive impact. And that was working for a major oil company and helping them think about how they attack market trends, whether it be changing retail fuels environment, such as the adoption of electric vehicles, changing consumer preferences, such as people, you know, starting to order more online because of COVID, because they are more sustainable consumers, helping the client, the energy company, rethink their business model, given those trends, understand how it's going to impact them, and therefore how to set priorities for investment over the coming 10 to 15 year period.
Are there any challenges or barriers that businesses face in their efforts to support sustainability, UN SDGs, these more socially and environmentally impactful initiatives that aren't necessarily their main drive their main sources of revenue and business?
Absolutely. There's a few barriers, right? One, investment, right? I think especially for energy companies, we talked about it a little bit, right? It's a complete rethinking of the business model. It's a complete change of their network, right? Their retail gas station network. It's thinking about it in a whole different way. And so one, it's investment that's required. It's political buy-in, right? It's difficult. People have different views about what it takes to achieve these goals, how fast they're going to be achieved, and therefore how they should allocate their investments across competing priorities. So there's several challenges, but among some of the most important ones, I see the capital infusion that's required and making sure we're all on the same page and pushing towards that goal, understanding the criticality of the priorities.
And with that, we'll just ask one final question. How soon do you think the world will be able to switch to renewable energy sources, given your work in the fuels and energy sector? It's challenging question, but how soon do you think we'll be able to do that?
Phenomenal question. So really, it's a tough one. There is no one answer, right? I think there's varying perspectives about the rate at which electrification and renewable energy changes will happen, right? Individuals have different perspectives on it. They make different assumptions. One, and again, some of these assumptions are dependent on when the price parity hits, right? When the infrastructure is there, the rate at which the government provides regulations and subsidies, right? So one of them is certainly driven by different people's perspectives. And two, it's going to vary vastly by different countries. I mean, in Norway, right? We talked about it. 30% of their car park is electric. Maybe more, maybe a little bit less, but around there, right? And they have 80% of their new car sales are electric vehicles, right? So in a place like Norway, pretty fast, we'll get there. In places in developing nations, right? It could take much longer. Again, electric vehicles are still expensive. The infrastructure requires investment. There are countries where the short-term need is poverty, right? So again, it's, as I've talked about before, it's a balance of priorities. And to answer your question, I don't think there's one answer. I think different countries, different regions are going to hit that renewable energy at different rates.
Very fascinating. Thank you so much for the thoughtful responses and insights. I'll turn back to Dr. Durbach to close out.
Thank you, Nico, very, very much for a very informative presentation. As I was saying, giving the consumers the opportunity to reject unsustainable products and practices is an absolutely excellent point of focus. And of course, governments can control the changes through their regulations. So thank you for coming and presenting it a perspective that many people just do not think of, because I think that it would never happen. And Susie, thank you very, very much for moderating. And I wish you a very wonderful, pleasant, and how should I put it, a very productive next week. Bye-bye.